All right, as you can see, the empennage kit for the RB-14 is here. I've gone through and inventoried everything, checked everything for damage or missing parts. Only thing I found, there were two bolts that were missing, and the only other issue was this piece, which is for the top of the rudder. It's actually for an RB-10. I contacted Vans, and they confirmed that this part number is for the RB-10. And so they're going to be sending me out a new piece along with the missing bolts, and hopefully I'll have those sometime next week. The whole process was pretty quick and easy. Just call them up, let them know, and they had no issues sending out the replacement parts. I've got the rest of my tools to get. I'm expecting them by the end of next week as well. I was fortunate enough to inherit my grandfather-in-law's tools from when he built his RV4 in the 90s, which included a C-frame dimpler and a pneumatic squeezer, along with buckets full of Clecos and some other tools. So it was a tremendous help in starting my tools. So now I'm just waiting for the other pieces. Like I said, hopefully in about a week or so I'll have those. I've set everything up in on my shelves, hanging the skins hanging from the storage rack here, trying to keep everything neat and organized. I've been speaking with several builders. That was probably the biggest tip that I got, was to improve or have good organizational skills with your parts. Makes it easier and faster as you're going through the process when you can find the parts relatively easily. Vans did a very good job in setting everything up in subkits, and it seems to be fairly like pieces were put together in these subkits. So we'll see as we go along, but I'll be able to look at the parts list to find out which subkit the part that I'm looking for is in, and I've got them situated in numerical order over on the racks here, so hopefully that'll help as I'm going through looking for parts. Other than that, today being the 2nd of November, I'm planning on this project in its entirety taking about 5 years. My tentative goal is to have the plane built and completed in time for Oshkosh of 2022. And if I did my math right, that should be the 50th anniversary for Vans. I'll have to verify the numbers later on, but I believe that to be correct. So that'd be a fun goal. I think the empennage kit itself will probably take me about a year, based on folks I've been following, both on their blogs for their builds, and there's a few folks I've been following on YouTube, and I recommend if you are interested in all in any of this, find these YouTube videos. I'll post the links below in the comments, but they have some outstanding videos of the whole process and explaining different things that they've come across and things like that. So I highly recommend looking around, finding these videos, and taking a look for yourself and see how you like it. It's seems to be a fun venture for anyone that has any inkling whatsoever. So like I said, I'm going to be working on this for as often as I can. I'm working out of my garage, so it makes it a little easier to come out and do some work. Even just a little bit of work each day helps tremendously in speeding up the process of getting the build complete. So that's my goal. I'll be posting these videos as I go. I'm new to editing and all this kind of stuff, so it might take a little practice. So bear with me. But if you're so inclined, please hit the like button. Even subscribe, if you will. That'll help me tremendously in getting my exposure out to get more people to see these videos. If you have a comment or a question, by all means, leave a comment down in the comment section below, and I'll try to answer anything I can. Again, I'm new to this, so I may not have any answers right away, but I appreciate any questions or things to get me looking, if nothing else. So, again, thank you. I hope to see some of you folks as I go along. And we'll see you in the next video.
All right, so with that, on to the first step of the first page for the empennage. In this step, you're going to take the forward spar for the vertical stabilizer and attach a doubler, a plate doubler, to the bottom of it. And so there's several holes that are, I believe they were, I think these were number 30 drills or holes for this. And then there's one larger hole using the number 12 drill bit. And the larger hole is for a bolt that holds the vertical stabilizer to the tail cone. So you attach, you drill through the holes, and again, it's match drilling for the most part. And so you drill through, and I'm real hesitant because it's the first time I've used these air tools, and just trying to get used to how they work, and so I don't want to put a whole lot of pressure because I'm afraid that I'll push through too hard, and when it finally clears through and makes and drills the hole out, then the drill itself will slam into the metal. So that's why you'll hear me use the trigger quite a bit and sounding like a machine gun. Just hesitance until I get used to the tools. And then as I go along, Clico everything in place, try to make sure it's held in place well enough that as I'm drilling the next hole, it's aligned as it should be. And this is where you'll see swapping over to the number 12 drill bit for the center of the bolt hole. And again, just got my tools in the previous part of this video. I'd mentioned I was waiting on my tools. I had just received them. I believe it only took a couple days later. This may have been the fourth or the fifth that I got the tools from Cleveland Tools. And I couldn't wait. As soon as they got in the mail, as soon as they arrived, I wanted to go out into the garage and start working. Unfortunately, I had to wait a little bit. Honeydew list, Thanksgiving, lots of stuff coming up, but managed to sneak out this day and actually start work, so I was pretty excited. Now here I am just going through, looking, verify the next step before I go on. And this is where take everything apart and try and then clean everything up. The next step in this is there's a bench just where I walked off on the left side of the screen there, where I have my my bench grinder, my drill press, and my bandsaw. And so here I'm fetching an extension cord. I still have to work out all the cords and everything because I've only got two outlets at the front of the garage there. And so that's one thing I'm going to have to work on, is getting power to everything and not having to swap the electrical cord from machine to machine as I go around the workshop. But so here you hear me on the off screen here working on my bandsaw, trimming off the bottom end of the forward spar where it meets up with the bottom edge of the plate doubler there. And then next step is to round off or radius the aft corners of where you just cut. And again, smoothing off the sharp edges to minimize chances of any kind of stress cracking or anything like that. And the point here is to reduce the sharp edges so you can run a finger over and not worry about cutting yourself, and make sure it's a smooth edge. And you can kind of call it the finger blood test, if you will. And again, that's, you're going to do that with all your edges, either with a hand file, or I've got a bench grinder with the 3M wheel that you see at the bottom of the screen there on the desk. That is more of a polishing wheel that will help round off and smooth out the sharp edges. And so you'll do that with all the edges and with any of the holes when you're deburring. That's kind of the point of that whole process. And so now I'm just looking over the plans again, just making sure I'm understanding the next step before I go through. I've already made a couple mistakes to the point of this editing this video, and I'll point those out in the next couple of videos as I come up to them. But can't stress enough how important it is to really look and understand the procedure, the plans and each step before you go through with it. It can get costly. It's definitely behooves you to double and triple check what you're supposed to do at each step. So now I'm starting to deburr some of the holes and still learning what the uses of each tools are as far as what their limits are. Decided I was going to try to deburr some of the number 30 holes, which are way too small to use the hand deburr tool that I have there. So then I go find my drill and use the hole deburr bit that I have. And you'll see here in a second, as I'm using it, I'm only doing a quick burst, as you see here, not intending to do any kind of countersinking or remove a whole bunch of material, more of just trying to get rid of the sharp edges or the little bit of hanging metal from when you drilled the hole. So it's just a quick burst with the drill gun to get rid of the sharp edges there. And then this is the larger hole I was able to use, the hand deburr tool here. And you do it on both sides of each piece, just again to make sure that there's no sharp edges that could lead to a crack later on. And with that, I think I'll finish out here. And like I said, my goal is to try to keep them around 10 minutes. This one was a little long, I apologize. So we'll see you in the next video. Thanks for watching.